Good evening and welcome to Paula Memorial. Before we light the Advent calendar, the final candle, I'd like to invite Amy and Amy to open our service. And we are blessed today with special musicians of Amy and Amy and Brent on the violin. Thank you so much, Amy and Amy. And I'd like to invite the family up to light our final Advent candle.
Sings the glory of God in the highest heavens.
Be not afraid. Be not afraid, for I bring you good news of great joy for all people. To you is born this day in the city of David a Savior, who is the Messiah, the Lord. You will find a child wrapped in bands of cloth and lying in a manger glory to God in the highest heaven, and on earth peace among those whom God favors.
At Christmas, God speaks in signs. The baby in the manger is a sign of new life and new governance shining in the world. Christ is born and the world is filled with the promise of hope, signs of peace, joy, and the incarnation of God's love.
Holy are you, source of all new life among us. Jesus Christ is the light of the world. We join with all creation in joyful praise. We light this candle because God has made
I invite you to stand if you're able as we sing our first hymn, Good Christians All Rejoice, in the blue hymn books. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, on this eve of Christmas, we gather before you to hear anew the story of the angels and Mary and Joseph, the shepherds and the wise ones, to hear about how you came and made a dwelling among us. Bless us, we pray, as we hear this story of old. Let it alight our hearts with your glory and love, as we remember that you have done so many wonderful things for your people, so that we could come and know you better. Be with us this evening and throughout tomorrow day, as we rejoice in the child found in the manger and the good news that he brought for all humankind. All this we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. This evening, we've gathered together under the light of the Christ candle to hear anew the story of our salvation, to sing the great songs of our faith, and to prepare our hearts and souls to celebrate the child found in the manger. Tonight is a night of stories and songs as we give thanks to the Lord for the great gift of Jesus coming to live among us. And so we start our evening of worship by raising our voices with one of the most well-known Christmas songs ever, hymn number...
You're a mean one, Mr. Grinch, you really are a heel. You're as cuddly as a cactus, you're as charming as an eel, Mr. Grinch.
I'm sorry, can I help you?
Well, no, I'm here to help you. You said we're going to sing one of the most well-known Christmas songs, so I started you off with my favorite Christmas song from The Grinch Who Stole Christmas. You know, the greatest Christmas story ever told, in my opinion. After all, it's a story that speaks directly to my heart. It's a story all about someone who's just sick of Christmas and all the overwhelming noises that come with its celebration.
I can understand. We all feel that way sometimes. But what makes you think that this is a story that I'm going to share?
Oh, well, you're kidding, right? I mean, I already looked at the church down the street. They were all going in with people dressed in robes, carrying shepherd's crooks and stuff like that, so they must be doing a Charlie Brown's Christmas. And there was another church that was, people were coming in and out of there looking like they were straight out of a Hallmark movie. So, and then I heard your organ, right? And that sounds just like the noise machines that the Who's use. And I knew right away that this was the place that my favorite story was going to be told. So I had to pop in to see if I could lend a hand. After all, I think I could portray the Grinch better than anyone else. And I even brought my own bag to steal your tree. But I might need a bigger bag. And I heard, too, that there's often a dog found in this building, so I figured you'd found Max. So can we get on with the story? I think there's even a little person here I see who could play Cindy Lou Who.
Okay, I think you're a little bit confused. The church where you saw people going in and out in costume, they're not doing a Charlie Brown's Christmas play. They're doing the Nativity story. You know, the story that Linus quotes at the end when Charlie Brown asks him what the true meaning of Christmas is about?
Yeah, no, that doesn't ring a bell. I remember Snoopy won the decorating contest, and then everybody sang around the tree as the credits were rolling.
Good grief.
So, are you going to tell about the greatest story of Christmas, or am I? Because I have no problem sharing with the world the best story that was ever told, and this story even rhymes. Does your story rhyme?
No, my story does not rhyme.
Well, there you have it. My story has to be better. It rhymes and it's illustrated. So, to show you that your story isn't as great as mine has its own song, several different movie adaptations, and people have even brought their families to have their picture taken with the lead character. I don't see a lot of people taking their holiday photos at the manger. Have you?
Certainly not. No one I know has done that. However, I don't really know how many mangers you find around Windsor. But if you want to take a moment, tell your story, just go ahead. I really don't think I can stop you. But make it fast. I still need to tell people about the birth of Jesus.
Yeah, okay, great. So my story starts with the Grinch, the man who hated Christmas, and everything that had to do with it. He hated the cheerfulness. He hated the smells of the season, the gift-giving, and the light-stringing. He longed for the silence to be found in his home. But it was not to be, because the city below him exploded every year with the celebration of Christmas. Now, no one knew why the Grinch hated Christmas so much. There are theories that his shoes were too tight, and others said that maybe his heart was two sizes too small.
Now that starts to sound a bit familiar to me. In the true Christmas story, there are quite a few people who sound like this Grinch.
Were they furry and green with red eyes and who planned to steal everything from the city?
Not exactly, but there was a man who was green with envy, and he longed to take away the reason why we celebrate Christmas.
Okay, that sounds exciting. Did he have a dog to help him with his dastardly plan?
No dog, at least that we know of. But he was a king who people said his heart was several sizes too small.
Tell me more about this king who tried to steal Christmas.
Well, in order to tell the story, I need to give a bit of a history lesson to set the stage for the true Christmas story.
Yeah, all right, I can handle a Christmas history lesson. It's great to know the backstory of what makes a person Grinch-like, even if they don't have green fur.
Where to start? Isaiah. Isaiah is a great place to start. You see, God's chosen people, well, they never had the most peaceful of history. They suffered under slavery, they were sent into exile when their city was destroyed, and when they were able to return, they found that their nation was taken over by the Roman Empire.
That would turn anyone into a Grinch if they had to experience all of that.
But you see, God's people didn't turn into a nation of Grinches. Instead, they chose to keep on loving and knowing that one day things would get better.
So what allowed them to stay hopeful after all the bad things that they'd faced?
What gave them hope was a promise that God had given to them long ago, a promise of a coming King of Kings, one who would transform the world from what it is now to what it was always meant to be.
What was this great promise?
I think it's better to hear it from the source, from the book of Isaiah.
The people walking in darkness had seen a great light. On those living on the land of deep darkness, a light had dawned. You have enlarged the nation and increased their joy. They rejoice before you, a people like a people rejoicing at a harvest. For unto us a child is born, unto us a son is given, and the government will be on his shoulders, and he will be called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. Of the greatness of his government and peace, there will be no end. He will reign on David's throne, and over his kingdom, establishing it and upholding it with justice and righteousness from that time on and forever. The zeal of the mighty, the Lord Almighty, will accomplish this.
I invite you to remain seated as we sing hymn number 122, O Come, O Come, Emmanuel. Verses 1, 3, and 4.
Well, that was a mouthful. I bet this Isaiah person was glad that he didn't need to find a rhyme for all those words, but What does it all mean?
What it means is that God, the creator of heaven and earth, had a plan to bring about the salvation of all of his people, that those who are trapped in the darkness of this world would soon be set free, for God was going to give us a Messiah.
Wait a minute, what is this darkness that you're talking about? And what is a Messiah?
Let me answer the last question first. A Messiah means God anointed. In the past and even today, people like priests and kings were anointed with oil to show that they'd been chosen to rule and look after God's people. So the Messiah is someone who God had anointed to care for his people, not only to rule over them, but to care for them, to put their needs before his own. And as for the darkness the people were walking in, well, it can mean many things, like people who are held hostage by depression or other forms of mental health. It can mean people who feel trapped by sickness or sorrow, but it also means people like your Grinch, who found his heart was two sizes too small. All of these things can be represented by the darkness that we sometimes have to walk through in this life. And the good news that Isaiah has to share is that God has a plan to lead us from the darkest places we may ever find ourselves wandering in.
Well, that's amazing. God had a plan for his people. But how long did they have to wait for this king to be born? Like a couple of hours, a day, a month, maybe a year?
Try 2,000 years.
Whoa. You're kidding me. Who would be willing to wait that long? I can barely wait for Christmas Day to be over, and it's only a day away.
God's people had to wait that long, but they didn't have to wait in silence. The Lord spoke through his chosen prophets and gave his people more and more information about the coming Messiah.
So he made it like a game of Clue? They had to piece everything together to find the hidden Messiah?
Something like that. But God had to wait till the time was right to send his Messiah.
Okay, so this Messiah was sent to save people like the Grinch?
Like the Grinch and, well, people like you and I.
Well, how'd he do it? Did he steal everyone's presents to let them know that Christmas came without all the bells and whistles and presents and roast beast?
No, God didn't need to send someone to steal Christmas away. Instead, he gave us the greatest present in the world, one that not even your Grinch or all the Grinches in the world could steal.
Something even a Grinch couldn't steal? Oh, I got it. I mean, like something like the CN Tower? There wouldn't be a bag big enough to steal that.
Nope, not stealing the CN Tower. Or really any other Christmas tree. Although there is something that's made from a tree in the Easter story. God was going to answer the prayers of his people and give them the long-awaited Messiah, but not in a way that anyone expected. For God was not only sending us a great king, he was going to come to earth to live among us.
Wait, God himself was the Messiah? Well, I guess that makes sense, because who else would be able to live up to all the promises that Isaiah and the other prophets were talking about?
Exactly. Out of love, God gave us his only son, who was born of a woman named Mary.
I'm sorry, God was born of a woman? How on earth did that happen?
The Gospel of Luke tells us how it happened.
In the sixth month of Elizabeth's pregnancy, God sent the angel Gabriel to Nazareth, a town in Galilee, to a virgin pledged to be married to a man named Joseph, a descendant of David. The virgin's name was Mary. The angel went to her, and she said, "Greetings, you are highly favored. The Lord is with you." Mary was greatly troubled at the words and wondered what kind of greeting this might be. But the angel said to her, "Do not be afraid, Mary. You have found favor with God. You will conceive and give birth to a son, and you are to call him Jesus. He will be great and will be called the Son of the Most High. The Lord God will give him the throne of his father David, and he will reign over Jacob's descendants forever. His kingdom will never end. How will this be, Mary asked the angel, since I am a virgin? The angel answered, the Holy Spirit will come on you, and the power of the Most High will overshadow you. So the Holy One to be born will be called the Son of God. Even Elizabeth, your relative, is going to have a child in her old age, and she was unable to conceive, but now she is in her sixth month. For no word from God will ever fail. I am the Lord's servant, Mary answered. May your word to me be fulfilled. Then the angel left her.
You're able as we sing hymn number 153, Joy to the World. That's it? An angel appeared before Mary and poofed a baby? I think I'll stick with my Christmas story. It seems much more believable.
No, that's not it. There was no sudden poof and a baby. What do you think this is, a cartoon? No, the angel of the Lord told Mary that she had been chosen to be the mother of the Messiah, that she would be the one to give birth to the long-awaited Savior, the one that their people had been waiting on for such a long time.
Well, how did Mary know that she was going to be able to do this? And what about the man she was supposed to marry? How did he feel about this so-called great news? I know I'd get pretty mad if John came home and told me that we were going to have a baby, but it wasn't mine.
I fully believe you might be slightly confused with that news.
Mary had faith in the good news that the angel had given her. She even went to see her cousin Elizabeth to discover for herself what the angel had said was true. When Mary got to Elizabeth, she was able to see that her cousin, who was, well, very old, was indeed pregnant with a child. And when Elizabeth heard Mary's voice, the child jumped in joy.
The baby in Elizabeth's womb jumped for joy.
Mm-hmm.
Now you're going to tell me he also had a special birth announcement.
Now that you mention it, he did.
No, stop right there. One story at a time. So Mary's going to have a child, and let me guess, Joseph decided to be a Grinch and want to steal Christmas away. That's what I think happens.
Happily, that's not how the story goes. Joseph was a good man, a faithful man, and he too was visited by an angel of the Lord in his dreams.
This is how the birth of Jesus, the Messiah, came about. His mother Mary was pledged to be married to Joseph, but before they came together, she was found to be pregnant through the Holy Spirit. Because Joseph, her husband, was faithful to the law, and yet did not want to expose her to public disgrace, well, he had in mind to divorce her quietly. But after he had considered this, an angel of the Lord appeared to him in a dream and said, "Joseph, son of David, do not be afraid to take Mary home as your wife, because what is conceived in her is from the Holy Spirit. She will give birth to a son, and you are to give him the name Jesus, because he will save his people from their sins." All this took place to fulfill what the Lord has said through the prophet: "The virgin will conceive and give birth to a son, and they will call him Emmanuel, which means God with us." When Joseph woke up, he did what the angel of the Lord had commanded him to do, and he took Mary home as his wife. But he did not consummate their marriage until she gave birth to a son, and he gave him the name Jesus.
must have been a very busy angel, flying here and there to let the people know about what God was about to do. But again, I ask, where is the Grinch in this story? He has to be at the center of the story, doesn't he?
Truthfully, he's not at the center of the story, but there are definitely some people who were, well, Grinch-like. Like in how they acted, one of them being Caesar Augustus.
Ah, so they had to deal with the Romans.
Yep, they were in charge of the land where Mary and Joseph and the others lived. And well, the Bible can tell this part better than I can.
In those days, Caesar Augustus issued a decree that a census should be taken of the entire Roman world. This was the first census that took place while Quirinius was governor of Syria. And everyone went to their own town to be registered. So Joseph also went up from the town of Nazareth in Galilee to Judea, to Bethlehem, the town of David, because he belonged to the house and line of David. He went there to register with Mary, who was pledged to be married to him and was expecting a child. While they were there, the time came for her baby to be born, and she gave birth to her firstborn, a son. She wrapped him in cloths and placed him in a manger because there was no guest room available for them.
See why you said some people were a little bit Grinch-like. Can you imagine having no place to rest after such a long journey? Let alone when you were about to have a baby. I would have thrown a fit at being told to lay my head down in a manger. That's not even fit for a dog, much less the Son of God.
And yet that's where Jesus was born, in a manger among the animals and his parents.
But why would God allow himself to be born in such a place? Why not in a palace, or at least a hotel, or anywhere other than a stable? Why was no one willing to make room for Mary and Joseph?
Why was no one willing to make room for your Grinch? He must have been hurting so much that his pain turned into anger against the celebration of Christmas.
I don't know, maybe that was just the way Dr. Seuss wrote him.
Or perhaps it was because everyone was so caught up in their own lives and their own celebrations that they never noticed that someone else was in need.
Well, you make a good point. What happens next?
Not everyone in that little town of Bethlehem was too busy to see what God was doing. In fact, there was a group who would soon hear the good news of the child found lying in the manger.
Well, these had better be the good people, because Mary and Joseph have gone through enough.
They were, for God sent them an invitation to come and celebrate the birth of the Lord.
And there were shepherds living out in the fields nearby, keeping watch over their flocks at night. An angel of the Lord appeared to them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them, and they were terrified. But the angel said to them, "Do not be afraid. I bring you good news that will cause great joy for all the people. Today, in the town of David, a Savior has been born to you. He is the Messiah, the Lord. This will be a sign to you. You will find a baby wrapped in cloths, lying in a manger." Suddenly, a great company of the heavenly hosts appeared with the angels, praising God and saying, "Glory to God in the highest heaven, and on earth to those on whom favor rests. Let there be peace." Then the angel had left them and gone into the heavens, and the shepherds said to one another, "Hey, let's go to Bethlehem and see this thing that has happened, which the Lord has told us about."
Well, I had a feeling that the angels were going to make another appearance. Now, shepherds, that was who was sent to see the King of Kings? Shepherds?
Why not shepherds? After all, one of the titles that would be given to Jesus was the Good Shepherd, the one who would lay down his life to protect God's beloved flock. So why not come and invite them to join in the celebration and the birth of Jesus? And let us rejoice with the angels by singing hymn number 147, "Angels We Have Heard on High."
Angels, we have heard on high, sweetly singing.
for both the powerful and the powerless, the saint and the sinner, and everything else in between. This is part of the reason why Jesus had to be born in a stable, because anyone could come and see him, rich or poor, young or old. All were welcome to see God's love made flesh.
So it was like the end of the Grinch's story that he was invited to the feast. And even after all that he did in his attempt to steal Christmas away, he was still welcomed to be part of the Christmas celebration.
That's right. At Christmas time, all are welcome to come, to hear the story of the child found in the manger, to hear the good news that the angels sang, to come and discover the great love that God has for each and every one of us.
Were the shepherds the only ones that came to see the baby Jesus?
No, there was another group of people who came to celebrate the infant King of Kings, and they had a run-in with the true Grinch of the Christmas story, a man named Herod.
After Jesus was born in Bethlehem in Judea, during the time of King Herod, Magi from the east came to Jerusalem and asked, "Where is the one who has been born, King of the Jews? We saw his star when it rose and have come to worship him." When King Herod heard this, he was disturbed, and all Jerusalem with him. When he had called together all the people's chief priests and teachers of the law, he asked them where the Messiah was to be born. "In Bethlehem, in Judea," they replied, "for this is what the prophet has written. But you, Bethlehem, in the land of Judah, are by no means least among the rulers of Judah, for out of you will come a ruler who will shepherd my people Israel." Then Herod called the Magi secretly and found out from them the exact time the star had appeared. He sent them to Bethlehem and said, Go and search carefully for the child. As soon as you find him, report to me so that I may go and worship him." After they had heard the king, they went on their way, and the star they had seen when it rose went ahead of them until it stopped over the place where the child was. When they saw the star, they were overjoyed. On coming into the house, they saw the child with his mother Mary, and they bowed down and worshiped him. Then they opened their treasures and presented him with gifts of gold, frankincense, and myrrh. And having been warned in a dream not to go back to Herod, they returned to their country by another route.
Herod did not want to worship this new king, did he?
No, he really didn't. Herod was so afraid of losing his throne that he wished the Messiah had never been born.
But the baby and Mary and Joseph, they're okay, right? Were they able to escape what Herod had planned?
They were able to escape, but Herod reminds us there are still people in the world who'd rather live in darkness than accept the light that Jesus brought into the world. Just as there are some people who would rather have their hearts stay two sizes too small than allow themselves to grow into something more than just a Grinch.
So what do we do to stop these types of people? How can we shine bright against the darkness that is found in the world?
You and I and everyone here, we've been given the power to stand up against the Herods of this world. We do this by allowing the light of Jesus to shine bright from our hearts, by choosing kindness instead of anger, by choosing to forgive as we've been forgiven, by choosing to love your enemies rather than hate them.
By choosing to be less like the Grinch at the start the movie and more like the Grinch at the end. More like Christ.
Now you have it.
That sounds like a lot of hard work.
It is. But think about how much better our world could be if you and I and countless others chose to follow in Jesus' way.
Everyone would be welcome at the feast. It'd be a celebration for the ages.
And that's God's plan, that one day the world will know his true and everlasting peace, that we'll all find our place at the coming kingdom of heaven.
Just like the Grinch.
Just like the Grinch.
I'm glad I came here today. It wasn't the story I expected to hear, but I think it was one I needed to hear.
I'm glad you came too. And now together we can celebrate the greatest story ever told, the story of a child found in the manger who would one day become a man who would walk on water, calm the sea, and the one who, out of love for us, was willing to go as far as the cross and the grave so that we could be brought together to a new life when he rose from the dead. For out of love for us, God came down and lived among us. And we respond to God's great gifts by offering up our time, our talents, our tithes, so they may be used to promote his good news and to share his light with the world around. For our guests who we have here, if you look in the pew in front of you, there are guest envelopes. And let us joyfully give to the Lord, who gave so much he came to live among us. Let us pray. Gracious God, you have given us everything we need,
And so we respond to your kindness and love with our own tithes and offerings. May they be used to share your good news with the world around us. All this we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. As is part of our tradition here at Paulin, we always close the Christmas Eve service with Silent Night. And you'll notice that you were all given a candle. I ask if you can push the candle up so the wick is over the plastic cup. And I'm going to demonstrate with the choir, and we are going to share the light of Christ, passing it from one person to another. The light of Christ with you to burn bright in the world around us. Go now in the blessing of God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. Amen. They will blow them out. Okay, they're blowing them out.